Hello friends, today we're going to discuss about the electronic mail, that is nothing but email. For email, you need the user agent, you need the message transfer agent, you need the message access agent. So we'll discuss all this in detail. So let us start with the electronic mail. So before go in detail, first we'll discuss about how will be the mail architecture. To explain the architecture of email, we give a four scenario. We begin with the simplest situation and add the complexity as we proceed. The fourth scenario is the most common exchange of the email. So now let us discuss the each scenario in detail, and then finally we come up with the final scenario for the email. Now let us discuss this first situation when the sender and the receiver of an email are on the same mail server and we need only the two user agent. Now see here, my two users are nothing but Alice and the Bob. They are directly connected to the system, or we can say it is a shared computer. Now Alice wants to send the mail to that of Bob. So the first, Alice has to open his mail address, that is nothing but UA, is nothing but the user agent. He has to open the mailbox, and once it opens the mailbox with the help of user agent, he can create the mail, or he can write the mail, and then it is forwarded. Then Bob to receive that or to retrieve that mail, he has to open his mailbox. So Bob then use his user agent, and with the help of that, it will retrieve the mail and he is able to read that mail. So can you see the Alice and Bob's, they are connected to the same system. So your mail user or mail server is directly connected to sender as well as receiver. So for that, you need only two user agent, one at the sender side and the second user agent at the receiver side. So that is the first scenario, and it is very simple scenario. Now let us discuss about the second scenario. When the sender and the receiver of an email are at a different mail server, we need the two UA, that is nothing but user agent, and pair of MTA, client and server. Now see here, in the last scenario, as you know, my both the sender and the receiver are connected to mail server directly. Now here we have the two different mail server. So now my sender is Alice. To create the mail, he has to open his mailbox with the help of user agent. He can create the mail. Once the mail is created, it will be forwarded to the mail server. The mail server will put that into queue, and then it will send to the internet. Now here you are connecting the two mail server, so for that you need the internet, and then it will receive to the MTA server. Now basically the MTA client, to push the mail, you need the MTA client, and to receive the mail, you need the MTA server at the other end. Now once the mail is received, the Bob, according to his convenience, he will open his mailbox, and then he will able to retrieve the mail. So the difference between the last scenario and this scenario, here you need MTA client and MTA server also, because there are two different mail server. In the previous condition, there was only a single server. For the pushing the data, you need the MTA client, and to receiving the data or receiving the mail, you need the another MTA server on the other mail server. Now see here the third scenario, when the sender is connected to the mail server via a LAN or a WAN, we need the two UA, that is user agent, and the two pair of MTA. MTA nothing but message transfer agent, client as well as server. Now see here, in the last case, my Alice was directly connected to the mail server. Now here we consider the Alice is connected to mail server through a WAN or a LAN. LAN means it is connected by the LAN cable, or WAN means it may be connected by the modem. So now in this case, first the Alice has to open the mailbox. With the help of user agent, he will create the mail, and to forward that mail from his PC to the mail server, he need one MTA client. At the receiver, you need the MTA server to receive that mail. Once it is received, then it is reached to the mail server. Now the mail server that will arrange in the queue, and then mail server again need another pair of MTA client to push that mail to the internet. And then at the receiver, we need the MTA server which take that mail, or we can, who can access that mail. And then it is stored in the mailbox of Bob. And Bob, according to his convenience, he will open it and he can able to retrieve the message. So basically in the last situation, we need only one MTA client and the server. But here we need the two MTA client and server. Because my sender is not directly connected to the mail server. He is connected by WAN and or a LAN. So to push your from your PC to that of mailbox, you need another MTA client and server pair. Now let us see the fourth scenario. When both the sender and the receiver are connected to mail server via LAN or a WAN, we need the two UA, that is user agent, two pair of MTA, that is message transfer agent, and the pair of MAA, that is nothing but message access agent. This is a most common situation today. Now, for example, you are accessing the Gmail. It is not necessary that your device is directly connected to the Gmail server. You may access your Gmail from your computer or handset. So the first is the user. This is my sender, or we can say this is my receiver. Now both my senders and receiver are connected by LAN or WAN to their mail server. So the Alice, first he will write the mail with the help of UA. That is nothing but the user agent. So once the mail is created, from my PC, it should be sent to the mail server. So for that, you need the MTA client, which will push the message, where the MTA server will pull the message. And then it is forwarded to my mail server. Then I need another pair of MTA client to push that mail from my mail server to that of Bob mail server. And then when it reach, and of course the internet is needed to connect the two mail server. Once it is received to the mail server of the Bob, now my mail has to forward from the server to the Bob machine. And for that, here we need the MAA server. MAA server is nothing but message access agent. Here now you need to pull your message. Here MTA will done the forwarding of the message or pushing of the message, where message access agent will do the pulling of the message. So with the help of MMA, the Bob will get the mail on his mailbox. So whenever he open his mailbox, he will able to retrieve the mails. So now can you see here, in the last situation, only the sender was connected by the LAN connection. Now here the sender and the receiver both are connected by the LAN connection. That is a real situation. As you know, my sender and receiver, they are not directly connect to the mail server. For example, you are using the Gmail. You are not directly connect to the Gmail. First, you have to access the Gmail. So for that, you need the MTA client and the MTA server. And then from this, once that mail is reached to the mail server, from that your mail has to push to the another mail server. For that, you need the another pair, that is a MTA client and the MTA server. Once it is received, then now the my receiver has to retrieve the data. For that he need the MAA server, is nothing but message access agent. Here you will do the pulling of the message. So for that you need this server. MMA server is pull that message, then it will reach to the Bob, and the Bob is able to access that mail. Now why we need the MTA client and server pair? Now see here the pushing of the mail. For pushing the mail, we need the MTI client and MTI server. So client pushes the message with the help of MTI client. Now at the receiver end, at the sender end, we need the pushing of the mail. But at the receiver end, you need the pulling of the mail. So that function is done by my MAA, that is nothing but message access agent. So message access agent will pull the message. Now let us discuss about what do you mean by the user agent. User agent is nothing but your mailbox is called as a user agent. The first component of the electronic mail system is a user agent. Just now we see that there are three important components. The first is a user agent, second is a message transfer agent, third is message access agent. So now let us discuss about the user agent. So that is the first component. It provides the service to the user to make process of sending and receiving of a message. So with the help of user agent, you can send your mail or you can receive your mail. When we create an email, the client software we use is called as a mail user agent. So basically to create the email, you need the one software that is called as mail user agent. The example is Outlook, Gmail. These are the example of user agent. So with the help of mailbox, you can create the message, you can send the message, you can receive the message. Now let us discuss the service provided by UA, that is a user agent. The user agent will provide you the composing of the message. With the help of mailbox, you can compose your message. Second, the reading of the message. You can retrieve the mail with the help of UA. Replying to the message, that functionality also provided by the UA. Forwarding of the message and handling the mailbox. All these facilities are provided by user agent. Now let us discuss about the format of the email. So basically this is the envelope part and this is a message part. Again, the message part is consist of header and the body. So envelope, it is containing to whom you are sending and from where it is sending. Means it is a user address as well as receiver address. Header, again, it is containing some more detailed information. The body means it contains the actual part of the mail. So just now we discussed the envelope contain the sender and the receiver address. The message contain the header and the body. As we know, there are two parts in the message. The first part is header and the second part is a body. See here, the message consists of header and the body. A header of the message define the sender and the receiver, the subject of the message and some other information. So whenever you are writing the email, you have to put the sender address, you have to put the receiver address, even you can add the subject. The body of the message contains the actual information to be read by the recipient. In the body, you are writing the actual information or the actual mail. Now let us discuss about the email address. So whenever you are sending the mail, you should know the email address of the receiver. So what do you mean by the email address? Let us discuss about it. Basically, it is consist of two parts. The first is a local part and second is a domain name. What do you mean by the local part? Local part means it is a mailbox address of recipient. For example, email ID is advait.bh@gmail.com. So advait.bh is nothing but the local part. gmail.com. Gmail means what? My mail server is Google. If it is Yahoo, then it will come @yahoo.com. Means the domain name will tell the name of the mail server. So local part, define the user mailbox where all the mail received by the user is stored for retrieval. Where the domain name, the second part of the address, and is the domain name, basically the domain name of the mail server. If it is Google, then @gmail.com will come. If it is Yahoo mail server, then it will come yahoo.com. Even if it is any organization, if you are in TCS, then tcs.com. If it is Reliance, then rcom it will come. So, and the organization usually select one or more host to receive and the send the mail. Now, let us discuss about the next important factor, that is a message transfer agent. Actual mail transfer is done through the message transfer agent. Once the mail is created, what is my next step? I want to transfer it, and that part is done by my mail transfer, message transfer agent. To send the mail, a system must have the client MTA, and to receive the mail, the system must have the server MTA. So it is like a client-server program. So to send the message, you need the MTA client, and to receive the mail, you need the MTA server. A formal protocol that defines MTA client and server in the internet is called as a simple mail transfer protocol. Now, which protocol is work in between this client and server? That is nothing but simple mail transfer protocol. As we said before, the two pair of MTA client-server programs are used in the most common situation. Now, have you remembered the fourth scenario? In that, we need the two pairs of MTA client and server. So now let us discuss about the important protocol, that is a simple mail transfer protocol. SMT is used two times, between the sender mail server and between the two mail server. Now basically, as you know, there are three steps, that is in between mail Alice and mail server, then the two mail server, and from mail server to the receiver. So basically SMTP is used between the Alice and mail server. So it is used between the sender and the mail server, and again it is used between the two mail server. At the third stage, what we use, that we'll discuss later, but SMTP is used till this point only for the two steps. So now let us discuss more about the SMTP. SMTP uses the command and response to transfer the message between the MTA client and the server. Now this is my client and this is my server. So how they will communicate? They can communicate by the command and the response. So now let us discuss about the different commands. So hello means, what is the meaning of it? It's nothing but the sender host name. Mail from means it is a sender message. Receipt, RCPT2 means it is intended recipient, means the receiver address. So these are the different command. Now let us discuss about the different response. So in response, he will give you the code. So now the code is nothing but here, 220 means service ready. 250 means request command completed. So in response, he will send the code. Now let us discuss how the connection establishment done between the MTA client and the MTA server. Now first, the server will send the message 220. 220 means what? Just now we see the 220 meaning the service is ready. So 220 service ready. Then client will send the response hello. Hello means here it will send the sender address. For okay, it will send the code 250. So in such a way, the connection establishment is done. Now let us discuss how the message transfers take place between the MTA client and the MTA server. So first, the client will give mail from, means it will give the sender address. Then MTS server will give the response by 250. 250 means okay. Then he will send the receiver address. Then my server will reply okay. And then he will type the data. And then he will give the response, that is 354. 354 means it is nothing but start of mail input. Your mail start. So from means it is sender address. 2 is nothing but receiver address. It put the date, it put subject. My client will put all this information and then the blank line. Then he will start writing the mail. Once it is done, then the server will give the reply 250 means okay. In such a way, the message transfer take place between the MTA client and the MTA server. When they want to terminate the connection, so the MTA client will send the quit and the MTA server will send the message or send the code, that is 221. 221 meaning the service close. In response, it always send the code. Now let us discuss about, just now we discuss about the message transfer agent, but at the receiver end, we need the message access agent. Now let us discuss about it. The first and the second stage of mail delivery use a SMTP. However, SMTP is not involved in the third stage. As we know, SMTP is present only for two stages, from my user to mail server and between two mail server. But now at the receiver, we need the message access agent. However, the HTTP is not involved in the third stage because SMTP is a push protocol. It pushed a message from the client to server. So SMTP, the main function done by this protocol is nothing but pushing of the message. But at the receiver end, you need the pulling of the message. A third stage need a pull protocol. The client must pull message from the server. The direction of the bulk data are from server to the client. Third stage use a message access agent. So as we know, the message transfer agent is needed when you want to push the messages or you want to push the mails. But at the receiver end, I need to pull the message. So for that, we have to use another protocol, that is a pulling protocol. So that is nothing but my message access agent. Now basically, there are two type of message access protocol. The first is POP3. POP3 is nothing but Post Office Protocol version 3. Next protocol is IMAP4. That is nothing but Internet Mail Access Protocol version 4. Now see here, between my user and mail server, I need the SMTP. Between my two mail server, again I need the SMTP. But between the mail server and the receiver, I need the message access agent. Now let us discuss about the POP3. Now this is my POP3 server and this is my POP3 client. So first step is you have to log in. So you have to put your username. And then the server will reply okay. Then you have to put your password. The client has to enter the password. Then server will reply okay. And then he is able to access his mailbox. Now let us discuss more about the POP3. The POP3 is a simple and a limited functionality. So basically the POP3 protocol is very simple, but it will provide you very limited functionality. The client POP3 software is installed on the recipient computer. The server POP3 software is installed on the mail server. So basically to access the mail, it is very important the POP3 software should be there at the receiver side, on the receiver PC. The POP3 has a two mode. The first is a delete mode and second is a keep mode. In delete mode, the mail is deleted from the mailbox after each retrieval. So once you read, that mail is automatically get deleted in the delete mode. Where in the keep mode, in keep, the mail will remain in the mailbox after retrieval. So in the keep mode, we are able to keep the mail in the mailbox even after reading it. There are lot many disadvantages of POP3 protocol. So let us discuss about the limitation. The first limitation is it does not allow the user to organize her mail on the server. You cannot organize your mail. You can't make out the different folders in your mailbox. That functionality will not be provided by POP3. The user cannot have the different folder on the server. Just now we discussed you can't arrange your mail, even you can't create the folder on the server. POP3 does not allow the user to partially check the content of the mail before downloading. So you just can't read the header. To read the message, you need to download it. Partially reading is not provided by the POP3 protocol. So now let us discuss about the next protocol is nothing but Internet Mail Access Protocol. So Internet Mail Access Protocol is similar to that of POP3 but has more features and it is more powerful and more complex. Just now we discussed the POP3 is very simple protocol and with the limited functionality, where the Internet Access Protocol is little bit more complex and provide you the more features than that of POP3. It provides the following extra function. The user can check the email header prior to the downloading. So before downloading, the partially you can check your mail and then you will decide whether you want to download that mail or not. That functionality that is provided by this Internet Mail Access Protocol. The user can search the content of email prior to downloading. Even he give the another feature that is nothing but searching feature. User can partially download email and this is specially useful if the bandwidth is limited. The email contain the multimedia with the high bandwidth requirement. For example, you have the less bandwidth and one mail come to your mailbox and you know that if you able to read it partially, you come to know that there is a content that is nothing but multimedia content and which require a very high bandwidth. So you will keep like that only. Whenever you will able to access the high bandwidth, that time you will download it. So because of the partial reading, this facility is provided with, you will decide whether you want to download that mail that time or not. This feature is basically provided by Internet Mail Access Protocol, which is not there in the POP3. Even the user can create, delete or rename the mailbox on the mail. You can delete the mail. That facility is provided by this protocol. Now let us discuss the comparison between the POP3 and the Internet Mail Access Protocol. The first comparison is POP3 is a simple protocol and allow the downloading of message from your inbox to your local computer. So basically in the POP3, you are able to download the mail only on your local computer. You cannot download on any other PC. Where in the Internet Mail Access Protocol, it is more advanced and allow view the user to see all the folders on the mail server. But this protocol is little bit advanced. It will give the facility to view your mails as well as folders. Next differentiation is to read the mail, it has to download on the local system. Just now we see that the partial reading is not provided by the POP3. If you want to read it, you have to download it. Here, the mail content can read partially before the downloading. But here in the Internet Mail Access Protocol, you are able to do the partial checking or a partial reading and then you will decide whether you want to download it or not. the user cannot organize the mail in the mailbox of the mail server. Here, you cannot organize your mail. You can't create your folders. But here, the user can organize the email directly on the mail server. The user cannot create, delete, rename the email on the mail server. That facility is not provided by the POP3, where the Internet Access Protocol will provide you to create, delete, rename the email on the mail server. After downloading, the message exists in the local system. If the local system crashed, the message is lost. Once you download that mail, that copy is there only on your local computer. And from your end, that got deleted, you will not get that copy. But in the Internet Message Access Protocol, the multiple redundant copy of the messages are kept at the mail server. In case the loss of message of the local server, the mail can still be retrieved. There are redundant copies. Many copies are there on the mail server. So even it is get deleted from your local drive, you are able to get that mail from the mailbox. The user cannot search the content of the mail before downloading to the local system. Searching option is not provided by POP3. With this, a user can search the content of mail before downloading the local system. So now let us discuss about the next protocol, that is nothing but MIME. MIME is nothing but multipurpose internet mail extension. So now the electronic mail has a simple structure. Now whatever the mail we are using, that having a simple structure, and it can send only NVT 7-bit ASCII format. In the other word, it has some limitations. So when the MIME was not there, with the help of your email, you are able to send only the NVT 7-bit ASCII format. The 7-bit ASCII format means it will not allow you the language like German, French, Russian. Even you can't send the binary data, you can't send the audio, you can't send the video. The multipurpose internet mail extension is a supplementary protocol that allows the non-ASCII data to send through the email. Basically, with the help of MIME, this is nothing but a supplementary protocol. So with the help of this protocol, you are able to send the non-ASCII data format like audio, video. MIME transfer the non-ASCII data at the sender side to NVT ASCII data and delivered it to the client MTA to be sent through the internet. The message at the receiving site is transformed back to the original data. Just now we discussed the electronic mail will send the data which is there in the NVT 7-bit ASCII format. So now let us take an example, audio, video. These are nothing but binary data. So first, that data with the help of MIME, it is converted to the NVT 7-bit ASCII format at the sender side. And then it will send over the internet and reach to the receiver. Then my receiver will again it decode back to normal, that is NVT 7-bit ASCII format. Then receiver side, your data is again converted into the format that is understandable at the receiver end. Now see this structure. This is my sender. Okay, now let us take an example, it is sending some audio. This is my receiver. So that is not a data in the ASCII format. So it is a, we consider this is as a non-ASCII code. So what the MIME do? It will convert that into the 7-bit NVT ASCII code. And then it is forwarded to the email. And from that email, at this is, the mail is forwarded at the receiver end, again the MIME is there, which convert this 7-bit NVT ASCII format into non-ASCII code and then it is forwarded to the receiver. So with the help of MIME, it is possible to send the audio, video through the email. Now let us discuss about the MIME header. So basically header contain, the first it contain the version, MIME, the current version is 1.1. Second, it contain the content type. Third is nothing but content transfer encoding. The third is content ID. Fourth is content description. And next is a email body. So in the email body, only this header is added. Now let us discuss about the each field. The first is MIME version. What do you mean by the MIME version? So just now I told you it defines which version you are using. That current version is nothing but 1.1. Next is nothing but content type. So this header defines the type of data used in the body. So what basically the body is using audio, it is sending video, that description is in the content type. So the data types, so you can send the text, it may be a plain text, HTML, it can be JPG, it can be MPG. So this all data types that is provided by MIME. Next is content transfer encoding. This header define method used to encode the message in 0 and 1s from the transport layer. Now basically the coding, it can provide you the 7-bit, 8-bit, binary coding, base64 coding, all these encodings are possible by using the MIME. Next is content ID. This header uniquely identifies the whole message in the multiple message environment. So basically the content ID, that is the ID given to that of packet. For example, a single message is divided into the 10 packets. So all the 10 packet will having the same content ID, because as you know, there are many number of message. In that you have to identify this message or this packet is belongs to which message. So content ID will give you that identification. The content description. This header define whether the body is image, audio, video. Thank you for watching this video. Stay tuned with Ekeeda. Subscribe Ekeeda.